And as you can see from my title, I'm going to talk about the molecular side of Quadrato, which is somehow the most challenging task that we could take in analyzing Quadrato. Quadrato, as you have heard, is a whole body motor meditation training aimed at enhancing cognitive functions, as you have already heard. And here I summarized basic results from the previous talks. From EEG, we have observed enhanced neuronal synchronization, and from magnetic resonance, increase in volume of gray and white matter, and increased functional anisotropy in corpus callosum, reflecting maybe inter-hemisphere better transfer. Our intention is to go to the next level, which is the analysis of possible molecular changes related to neuronal functions in subjects performing Quadrato. As you know, the adult brain architecture is the result of a complex interaction between genetic programs that are active throughout the development of the organisms and processes of plasticity driven by experience. And experience is a broad area, including sensory experience, emotional experience, environmental stimuli, and so on. So what we know is that intrinsic neuronal activity as well as environmental stimuli can trigger processes of neurogenesis and neuroplasticity mediated in part by neurotransmitters that are the modulators of the electrical activity of neurons and neurotrophins, specific molecules, proteins that regulate neuronal growth and differentiation of neurons. The neurotrophins are a family, including nerve growth factor, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, neurotrophin 3 and 4-5. The first neurotrophin discovered was NGF by Rita Levi-Montalcini many years ago, and she showed for the first time how this protein could promote axon and dendrites growth in cultured neurons and also promote repair of spinal cord injuries in mice. Now we know that neurotrophins are involved in development, differentiation and repair of neurons. Don't be afraid of looking at this picture because this is quite complex. All I want to say is that neurotrophins are produced in the central and peripheral nervous system, mainly released in the synaptic space, and they are internalized in the postsynaptic membrane after interaction with specific receptor called tropomyosin-related kinases. This interaction triggers a number of complex biochemical pathways that eventually lead to growth and maturation of dendritic spines, growth of cytoskeleton in the elongating axon, release of presynaptic neurotransmitters. I would like you to keep in mind that neurotrophins, as I said, interact with specific receptors and then can mediate synaptic plasticity, survival, and differentiation. But they are produced as longer precursors that later undergo maturation through enzymatic cleavage in the synaptic space. The mature neurotrophins bind to the specific TRK receptor, but also the neurotrophins can bind with high affinity to alternative receptors called P75 sortilin, and it's been recently discovered that they could trigger also apoptotic cell death in some cases. This proneurotrophin-mediated cell death is active in aging and in neurodegenerative diseases. What is interesting is that in Alzheimer's patients and subjects with mild cognitive impairment show higher levels of pro-NGF in their brains. Neurotrophins are also produced in peripheral tissues. Here are a number of those. It can be easily detected in plasma and is heavily produced also in salivary glands. And it is measurable also in saliva, both in humans and animal models. There are lots of studies done on animal models, specifically in mice, where the neurotrophin role has been related to the production of neurotrophins has been related to stress. Why am I mentioning stress? Because I want to say that the neurotrophins are in strict relationship with the environment. So they are, they mediate what is the response to the external environment. There are animal studies and imaging studies of adults that show that BDNF, one of the neurotrophins I mentioned, is involved in coping with stress conditions, post-traumatic disorders, early life adverse experiences. And for example, in animal models, BDNF levels are strongly reduced in several brain districts, such as prefrontal cortex, amygdala, and hippocampus. The response to stressful conditions is conveyed to the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis and is delivered systemically. On the other hand, improving the environment can also have a strong impact on neurotrophin production and in structures of the brain. Here is an example of studies made in animals where the environment has been enriched through a number of combination of motor training, cognitive tasks, and others. And in this case, a robust increments in cortical thickness and weight has been revealed, and also a strong increase in dendritic arborization, number of dendritic spines, and synaptic density. Some studies have also been performed in humans where there is evidence for improved working memory and increased BDNF expression and production following physical and cognitive activity, especially in combination. So, based on this, we have decided to study the levels of neurotrophins in subjects performing the quadrato motor training. We have taken saliva samples from 20 healthy female subjects performing quadrato for 28 days and the same number of controls, who have only performed a simple 10 minutes random walk. All the samples were collected at the same time in the morning and analyzed as triplicates at day 1 and day 28. And the samples have been analyzed with two different technical approaches, the ELISA and Western blot analysis. The first one, ELISA assay, is an immunosorbent assay. Briefly, the saliva samples are applied to 96 Wells plates, coated with a capturing polyclonal antibody, and the specific neurotrophin is identified and measured through the interaction with a specific antibody raised toward that specific neurotrophin. The signal is detected as fluorescence generated by a chemical reaction driven by a secondary antibody. So what we measure is actually a fluorescent signal. Here basically is the results of what we have found after 28 days. In here you can see that after 28 days not all the participants came back. Only 15 quadrato participants and 7 controls. The amount of NGF levels was measured relative to a standard curve, and each histogram is the average of the triplicate sample. So what we can see from here is that the general trend for the Quadrato participants for NGF is to show an increase, a decrease of levels of NGF after performing Quadrato for 28 days. While in general, the seven controls showed either no change or a slight increase. Since the ELISA assay doesn't discriminate between the various forms of NGF, we decided to use a second technique that allows us to see specifically the forms, the different forms of NGF. And this is the Western blot. The saliva samples are applied to, are subjected to electrophoresis on acrylamide, polyacrylamide gel. And so the proteins move in this gel according to their molecular weight. Then they are transferred to a support membrane, and the detection of specific proteins in the membrane is still done through by the use of a specific antibody that detects the specific proteins that we can see visualized as bands on the membrane. Here, for simplicity, I only show you the case of three participants, two QMT participants and one control, just to give you an idea of what we see on these gels. This is the signal that we get. This band that you see here is the pro-NGF that we identified according to molecular weight. And at day 1 and at day 28, the triplicates. What we can see clearly here is that the QMT participants show a strong decrease of pro-NGF, which is in accord with the ELISA experiments that I showed you before, while we don't see any change in the control. Now this is only an example that as I told you, but we are still analyzing all the participants through this technique. A partial result of what we have seen is in this slide, where we are still not able to include all the participants, but again we see that the most of them show a significant decrease of pro-NGF, while no major variations are observed in the control group. It is important to notice that we never find the mature form of NGF, but this is not surprising because, according to what has been published in literature, after pro-NGF is matured, the mature NGF is rapidly internalized in the post-synaptic membrane or degraded in the case it's not used. So it is quite expected that we don't see any mature NGF in our samples. Extrapolating this model to the peripheral tissues, we can explain why we don't detect the mature NGF in saliva, and we hypothesize that it's the mature form is rapidly used in the subjects performing Quadrato. Subsequently, in the second experiment, we have performed the same kind of experiment on the three subjects that Filippo Carducci has showed you before, that have been practicing Quadrato motor training for 3 months and have also been analyzed by magnetic resonance. For these subjects, these are three subjects, as I said, the levels of pro-NGF are still decreasing quite clearly for two of them. But what is really interesting is that when we decided to look also at pro-BDNF, we found a strong increase in all of them. So the band is, as you can see, is much stronger than at the beginning. And this is always consistent. So what we have seen is that another neurotrophin also changes its levels very strongly after Quadrato motor training. In conclusion, what I want to say is that pro-NGF is the prevalent form that we detect in saliva of all the participants, that after 1 month of practice, 28 days of practice, we can see a strong correlation with reduced levels of pro-NGF in saliva in QMT participants versus controls, and this has been detected by two different assays. The reduction of pro-NGF levels is still observed after 3 months of practice, and after 3 months of practice we also see a strong correlation with increase of pro-BDNF levels. Obviously, this can allow us to hypothesize that all the changes in neuroplasticity that we have seen before with EEG and with magnetic resonance could be mediated through changing in different levels of neurotrophins, so can be mediated through the molecular level. As future perspective, of course, we would like to increase and enlarge our number of participants to, let's say, support and let our results stronger. Then one other idea is that to look for other genes or other molecules involved in the neuroplasticity that could be involved in this processes by analyzing genome-wide the genome of the QMT participants and see how many and if there are genes that are differentially expressed after training. And maybe a longer shot would be also to investigate the epigenetic regulation of those genes, the ones that we know that are changing in this practice, and eventually others. This is because epigenetic leads to, allows the study of, directly the study of effects of the external environment on genome and on molecular aspects. Finally, I want to mention the person involved in this project, Dr. Micaela Caserta and Loredana Verdone from Istituto di Biologia e Patologia Molecolare CNR in Rome, Dr. Tal Dotan that you know already, and we are deeply thankful to Patrizio Paoletti and its foundation for supporting and encouraging this project. Thank you.